Hello everyone. In this video, I will tell you about alveolar bone. Alveolar bone is that part of maxilla and mandible that supports and protects the tooth. It is dependent on the presence of teeth for its development and maintenance. So what this statement means is that when the teeth are present, the alveolar bone is well developed. And when teeth are absent, alveolar bone is poorly developed. The diagram at the bottom of the page shows the alveolar bone supporting a tooth which comprises of both compact and cancellous bone. So let's now go to the classification of bone in general. So bones may be classified developmentally, histologically, and based on their maturity. So let's first go to the developmental classification of bones. Developmentally, bones may be classified as intramembranous and endochondral. The endochondral bones form by ossification of cartilage, and intramembranous bones form within a vascular fibrous membrane. So the intramembranous bones include cranial vault, maxilla, mandible, and clavicle. The endochondral bones include skull base, vertebrae, long bones, and pelvis. Histologically, bone may be classified as compact and cancellous. Compact bone, also known as cortical bone, has relatively higher density as compared to the cancellous bone. It forms the outer and inner cortical plates around a tooth. The cancellous or the spongy bone has relatively lower density. It forms a lattice-like arrangement of individual bony trabeculae that surround soft tissue. So what is this soft tissue? This soft tissue is nothing but the marrow, that is yellow or red bone marrow. In this diagram, you can see the cross-section of a root in the center. The bone immediately surrounding the root is called alveolar bone proper, and it is the inner cortical plate. The bone on the buccal and lingual sides of the alveolar process, that is the buccal and the lingual cortical plates, are the outer cortical plates. The low density bone between the outer and inner cortical plate is called the spongy or the cancellous bone. The yellow portion in the central porous region represents the individual bony trabeculae of spongy bone, while the gray area represents the marrow spaces. Now, based on maturity, bone may be classified as woven bone or immature bone and lamellar bone or mature, also known as adult bone. So, woven bone is the newly formed bone, and collagen in woven bone has a relatively more variable diameter and the fibers are randomly oriented. So this gives the bone a matted or basket weave appearance, and hence the name woven bone. Osteocytes in woven bone are large and they are numerous. You can say that they occupy about 30% of the bone volume. The woven bone shows rapid formation and mineralization as compared to the lamellar bone, and also it has a higher turnover rate. It is rich in acid phosphoprotein and BSP. BSP means bone siloprotein. It is the first bone to form at the site of healing. Now the lamellar bone, it forms eventually from immature bone. The collagen fibers have a more regular arrangement as compared to the woven bone. Osteocytes are smaller, they are flattened and regularly spaced. Osteocytes are relatively less numerous and they occupy about 2% of the bone volume as compared to the 30% bone volume in woven bone. Lamellar bone is rich in osteocalcin, and the lamellar bone shows slow rate of formation and mineralization as compared to the woven bone. It also has a slower turnover rate. Let's now go to the gross morphology of alveolar bone. Interdental septum represents the part of alveolar bone separating the individual sockets. That is, that part of alveolar bone between two teeth is called interdental septum. While the interradicular septum represents that part of alveolar bone separating roots of a multi-rooted tooth. That is, the part of alveolar bone found between the roots of the same tooth. So, for example, the part of alveolar bone between the mesial and distal roots of the mandibular molar. So, that would be called a interradicular septum. And the part of alveolar bone between molar and premolar, or between two premolars, would be called a interdental septum. The inner cortical plate, that is the compact bone lining the tooth socket, is known by three different names. So they are, number one, cribriform plate. Now why is it called cribriform plate? Because of its sieve-like appearance. Now the sieve-like appearance is caused by several Waksman canals, that is due to vascular channels that are passing through the inner alveolar bone to the periodontal ligament. It is also known as bundle bone, as the Sharpe's fibers from periodontal ligament embed into the alveolar bone. Now what are Sharpe's fibers? These are the part of periodontal ligament fibers that embed either into the bone or cementum. So because of this feature, it is called bundle bone. Now the third name, it is also called lamina dura based on its radiographic appearance. The alveolar bone appears a dense white line on the radiograph. Now this dense white line appearance is not because the alveolar bone has different composition in the compact bone region and the spongy bone region. No, the composition is same. It's just that the spongy bone has more of soft tissue spaces within it. That is the marrow spaces. Whereas these spaces are lacking in the compact bone. So it appears more dense. The thickness of the inner alveolar plate, that is the cribriform plate, is about 0.1 to 0.5 mm. And the external alveolar plate thickness is variable. For example, it is about 1.5 to 3 mm on the posterior teeth. So it is thicker on the posterior teeth as compared to the anterior teeth. Let's now go to the chemical properties of bone. Bone, as you all know, is a mineralized connective tissue. The inorganic component comprises about 60% by weight or 36% by volume. Organic component comprises about 25% by weight or 36% by volume. And water comprises about 15% by weight or 28% by volume. Let's go to the inorganic phase. Just like enamel or any other mineralized tissue, the inorganic part is formed by hydroxyapatite crystals. Now most of these hydroxyapatite crystals are carbonated, that is, they contain a molecule CO3. This inorganic phase provides hardness and rigidity to the bone. The hydroxyapatite crystals have a needle-like shape or thin plate-like shape. They are about 50 nanometer in diameter and 8 nanometer in thickness, and they have a variable length. Though you may say that on an average they have a length of about 150 nanometers. Let's now go to the organic phase. About 90% of the organic phase is formed by collagen, and of that mainly it is type 1 collagen. So most of this collagen is intrinsic, that is, it is secreted by osteoblasts, and the remaining collagen is extrinsic, that is, it can be classified as Sharpe's fibers, which we have already discussed, and the Sharpe's fibers, that is the extrinsic fibers, are secreted by fibroblasts. As I have already told you, type 1 collagen is the dominant collagen type. Type 3 and 5 collagens are also seen in the bone, though they are found in immature or healing bone. Collagen imparts load-bearing capacity and resiliency to the bone. It means that it prevents the bone from easily fracturing. Apart from collagen, there are several other proteins that can be classified as non-collagenous proteins. These form about 10% of the organic phase. So 90% is collagen and 10% is non-collagenous proteins. These are heterogeneous group of about 200 proteins. That is, they are different types of proteins. And the main amongst them include, number one, proteoglycans. For example, decorin, biglycans, and versicin. Second one, glycoproteins like osteonectin, osteopontin, bone siloprotein, thrombospondin, and fibronectin. Bone GLA containing proteins like osteocalcin. And there are several other serum proteins like albumin. So these glycoproteins have a role in both bone formation and resorption. As already mentioned, glycoproteins include osteonectin and osteopontin, bone siloprotein, and fibronectin. Osteonectin binds to calcium and collagen, so it can be said to have a role in mineralization. Osteopontin, bone siloprotein, and fibronectin bind to osteocytes, thus they adhere to matrix. Now, they are said to modify the behavior of bone cells, that is osteocytes, and thus you may say that they participate in bone remodeling. So for mineralization, osteonectin, and for bone remodeling, osteopontin, bone siloprotein, and fibronectin. Let's now go to the proteoglycans. Notice in the animation below that the proteoglycans bind to the collagen. This may help regulate the collagen fibril diameter. So we may say that proteoglycans also play a role in mineralization of the osteoid or the organic matrix of bone. Osteocalcin is a calcium binding protein which helps in mineralization. Since it is synthesized by only osteoblasts and odontoblasts, they may help identify the lineage of cells as either osteoblast or odontoblast. So what it means is that if you find osteocalcin in a tissue, so you can based on this molecule easily identify whether that tissue is derived from osteoblast or odontoblast. Other exogenous proteins present in bone include, number one, cytokines like interleukins, tumor necrosis factor, and colony stimulating factor. Second, growth factors like transformation growth factor, fibroblast growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, and insulin-like growth factor. Number three, BMP, that is bone morphogenic protein, which is a part of TGF beta superfamily, are osteoblastic. That is, they have a role in bone formation. All of these exogenous proteins play a role in bone remodeling. So with that, we have completed the organic component of the bone. The newly formed unmineralized organic matrix of bone is called osteoid. It is analogous to predentine. So same as predentine is in dentine, in bone it is osteoid. And here it is secreted by osteoblasts. Its thickness ranges between 5 to 10 microns and its mineralization front, that is the leading plane in which mineralization is taking place, appears linear. The type 1 collagen fibers which form the main bulk of organic matrix are arranged parallel to the bone surface, as you can see in this diagram. Now when this organic matrix of the alveolar bone, or for that matter any bone, is first mineralizing, the mineralization is controlled by osteoblasts. So what it means is that the type of mineralization is vesicular. Vesicular means here the first crystal form within the matrix vesicle that are secreted by osteoblasts. So osteoblasts would provide with ready-made inorganic crystals, right? So mineralization is directly controlled by osteoblasts. Let's now go to the organization of bone. Now, be it compact or cancellous bone, bone is always deposited in a lamellar pattern. That is, the bone deposition takes place layer by layer. In the compact bone, the lamellae are arranged in two patterns. First pattern is seen at the external and internal that is periosteal and endosteal surfaces, and this is called circumferential lamellae pattern. And the second pattern is seen deep to the circumferential lamellae, and this is called osteon or the Hevergian system. So at the external and internal surfaces, the lamellae are arranged in a parallel layer, as you can see in the diagram, and these parallel lamellae completely surround the bony surface, and that's why they are called circumferential lamellae. Now let's go to the arrangement of lamellae in osteon. They are seen deep to the circumferential lamellae, and they are formed by arrangement of lamellae in small concentric layers around a central neurovascular canal, which are about 50 microns in diameter. The Hevergian canal with the concentric lamellae form one osteon, and this osteon can also be known as Hevergian system. About 20 lamellae may be seen in one osteon. Collagen fibers are parallel to each other in one osteon, but they have a different orientation from the adjacent osteon. So within one osteon, all the lamellae will be parallel to each other, but in the adjacent osteons, their orientation would be different. Now apart from these, some unusual coarse fibers may sometimes be seen within the bone. In reality, these are nothing but the Sharpey's fibers. So what happens is that after remodeling, the circumferential lamellae with Sharpey's fibers may be seen in deeper sections of bone. So due to remodeling, new bone will keep on forming, and the bone that already contains Sharpey's fibers would be seen or would migrate deeper. So these fibers may be seen deeper to the surface. So there are nothing unusual about it. It's just that the bone has remodeled and the Sharpey's fibers are embedded deep to the surface. Let's now go to the organization of spongy bones. Here, the lamellae are opposed to form trabeculae, which are up to 50 microns in thickness. And these trabeculae are aligned to the lines of stress. That is, their long axis is aligned to the lines of stress. This arrangement enables them to withstand the applied force with minimum mass. These trabeculae surround narrow soft tissue spaces, and these spaces are called bone marrow spaces. So depending on the bone, it could be either red bone marrow or yellow bone marrow. These marrow spaces supply nutrition. Now marrow in the young bone is red and hemopoietic in function, whereas in old bones, yellow marrow is seen. In yellow marrow, there is loss of hemopoietic potential, and it appears yellow due to increased fat cells. The spongy bone has a higher turnover rate. Now finally, let's go to the role of alveolar bone. The alveolar bone holds the tooth firmly in position during mastication. It also helps to move the teeth for better occlusion. It supplies vessels for the periodontal ligament and cementum. They house and protect developing permanent teeth while supporting the primary teeth. They also organize successive eruption of primary and permanent teeth. So that's all for now. I hope this video on alveolar bone was helpful. Do let me know your views on it. Thank you.